the midst of all of that. And we have to get real, because sometimes these tensions exist in relationships between each other, and in marriages, and in friendships, and on jobs. There are two passages of scripture I would like you to focus on with me today. We kind of picking up, and I was going to do this a couple weeks ago, but I was not able to preach it. But in the Bible, in 1 John, the end of the Bible, 1 John, the 4th chapter, if you would just join me there, and then there's going to be a second scripture verse comes from the Gospel of Matthew 24. But in 1 John chapter 4, look with me at verse 7. It is our challenge. It is our challenge. And I raised that a few weeks ago when I preached. And there is a warning and caution to all of us. And I think these scripture verses and some other ones that we will teach on today. Amen. In 1 John 4, amen. Verses 7 and 8. When you have found it, would you say amen? Amen. Hear these words. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. And everyone who loves has been born of God. And watch this, and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Now look with me over at Matthew 24, beginning at verse 12. We're gonna read verse 12 and 13. Amen. Matthew chapter 24, verse 12 and 13. Amen. Verse 12 and 13. Hear these words as Jesus was talking to the crowd about the signs of the end of the ages. Amen. This is Mike messing up. Amen. Devil don't want me to preach this. Where's that other mic at? That other hand held mic. Amen. Praise God. Where's that other hand held mic at? Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. This one did not act up either. You ain't got it on. Amen. Let's read this. Amen. In Matthew 24, verse. Amen. Matthew 24, verse 12. It reads this way. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of many will grow cold. Did y'all hear that? But he who stands firm to the end will be saved. Amen. 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 Praise God. I want you to be seated on that, because we're going to pray that God blesses the reading and the hearing of this holy word. And here's what I want you to think upon today. This is the subject. Don't let your love grow cold. Amen, amen. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, don't let your love grow cold. Amen, praise God. Here is the challenge, brothers and sisters, in the time that we have today. John, in 1 John 4, calls upon all of us who are disciples of Jesus to love one another. John in this passage speaks about agape love. Agape love is the foundation of Christianity. Agape love is unconditional love. Agape love is different from other kinds of love. In the English version, in the English language, the word love covers all kinds of love. It covers friendship love. It covers family love. It covers romantic love. It covers every kind of love when we use the word love in the English language. But in the Greek and Hebrew, particularly the Greek, the word agape means unconditional. the love. Agape love comes from God. Amen. And through the Holy Spirit, God gives us the ability to love our neighbors unconditionally. Amen. This love cannot come. And when you have this love, it is evidence of your rebirth in Jesus Christ. Amen. John says in 1 John 4:8 that whoever does not love unconditionally, amen, does not know God. Amen. The Bible indicates, and this is what bothered me, that somehow I don't know God if I don't know how to love unconditionally. And I began to think about that, because I began to think about in this election you have Christians who are on different sides of the aisle. And that's not the problem, that we're on different sides of the aisle. But the problem is we have used our ideological positions to dislike one another and to hate one another over ideological differences. And I began to think, all of us who go to church on Sunday morning, and sometimes our churches are segregated, black and white. You go to white churches, there are white people in churches. You go to black churches, and black folk are in churches. And sometimes we confess that we love one another, but we don't worship together. We don't even know how to worship one another, because we like this way, we like worship this way, they like worship that way. But the Bible said we ought to love one another unconditionally. And if we don't love one another unconditionally, then John said we don't know God. I'm not going to give many amens today. Amen. See, the very nature of God, Sylvia, is love. That's the very nature of God, is love. All God's works are based on love. God's creation of us is based on love. God sending Jesus into the world was based on love. God's redemptive act on the cross through Christ was based on love. God's forgiveness of our sins is based on love. Deserve it, but it's because he loves us unconditionally. His redemptive act of Calvary was not because we were so good. It was the opposite. We were so bad. But he died on the cross out of love for us. He forgives us of our sin based on love, unconditional love. To know God is to allow God's Holy Spirit to manifest that kind of love in our bodies. When God's love is imparted in us, that means when God deposits his love in us. Our challenge is not to allow God's love in us to grow cold. Jesus says in Matthew 24:12 that there will be a time when there will be an increase in wickedness. An increase in wickedness. And he says, when this increase occurs, a lot of people in the body of Christ will allow their love to grow cold. See, when you join the church, and I tell people, when you give your life to Jesus Christ, that's when the devil is going to come at you. Amen. The devil doesn't mind us doing what we just did. We had a good time in the Lord here just a while ago. We were singing and praising God. The devil doesn't mind us doing that. But before you leave this church, or when you leave this church, or when you're on the parking lot, or when you go to eat dinner, or sometimes during the day or early tomorrow at work, the devil's going to challenge your so-called love for God. The word cold means when sin turns our focus on ourselves and our desires. When we stop focusing on God. See, when we stop focusing on ourselves and our desires, then our love will grow cold. When we fail to love our neighbor with unconditional love, that is a sin. And when sin gets in, our agape love will turn cold in three places. Three places. First of all, it's going to turn cold in your heart, your feelings.
That's right.
violence toward your neighbor will turn cold because your neighbor has hurt you. And when they have hurt you, when wickedness comes, the Bible says be careful because it will cause your love to turn cold. Your feelings toward them turns cold. Why? Because you're taking your focus on God and putting it on yourselves and your desires. The second place it turns cold is our soul. A will to love. A will to love turns cold against our neighbor. Why? Because our feelings are messed up. And when our feelings are messed up, then it messes with our will. Amen. Because when our emotions are all in this thing and we no longer want to love people, then it affects our will to do it. So it messes with our heart. Our heart has turned cold. And when your heart turns cold, it will affect your soul, your will to do God's will. And then it affects your mind. It affects your thinking and your attitude about them. Your attitude towards them turns cold. Amen. You don't greet them the way you used to greet them. You don't speak to them the way you used to speak to them. You don't embrace them the way you used to embrace them. You don't hang with them the way you used to hang with them. Why? Because your heart has turned cold. Your soul has turned cold. And your thinking about them has now changed. Cold love is pretense. In Romans 12, verse 9, it says, love must be sincere, hates what is evil, clings to what is good. We pretend like we are not mad at them. Amen. We pretend like we're not holding a grudge against them. We pretend like we like them. We pretend like we're getting along with them. But check this out. We can pretend all we want. Because there's somebody that knows what your heart is thinking. Amen. See, you can pretend to me. I can pretend to you. But you can't fool God. And God knows that your love for them has grown cold. Normally, there are three things that can cause our love to grow cold. Number one, when we allow our personal negative feelings toward our neighbor to influence how we view them and treat them. Now watch what John says in 1 John 4, beginning at verse 19. Because we love because he first loved us. Why do we love? Because he did what? He first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, yet hates his brother, he is a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And he has given us this command, whoever loves God must also love his brother. Wouldn't it be tragic if you died and went to heaven and the person you didn't like but showed up as God? Speaking to and you walked into glory and there they were standing before you on the throne of God. Don't you know, brothers and sisters, that all of us were created in the image of God? Don't you know that all of us are God's creation? God said, how can you love me and you ain't never seen me, but yet you hate your brother or your neighbor who you see every day? What would you do if you hate black people?
Yeah.
God said, you are lying. And the Bible said, you don't know me when you act that way. All this preaching will do me no good if I can't love unconditionally. I will take this road to hell with me if I don't learn how to love like God loves. Well, Lord, I preached 9,000 sermons for you over 40 years. I preached. Don't make no difference, Harrison. Because you didn't know me. What do you mean I didn't know you? I was there every Sunday. I never missed a Sunday. You know, Lord, for you. I was faithfully there every Sunday. But Harrison, you don't know me. Well, Lord, what do you mean I don't know you? Because you didn't love like I love. Number two. I can get it done in 10 minutes. When we keep the score of our neighbor's wrongs, it will cause your love to grow cold. But Harrison, what do you mean? In the book of 1 Corinthians 13, verse 5, it says this. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no records of wrong. We keep score. We keep score in our hearts. We keep score in our souls. And we keep score in our minds. And every time they do something to us, we keep a record of it. And we keep writing it down. And we write it down. And we keep writing it down. And we put a check by it. And we put another check by it. And we put another check by it. And we just keep putting checks. And we keep putting checks. But what if God started holding a record of wrong against us? And what if every time we could sin, God put a check mark by it? We put a check mark by it. See, if God put a check mark by every sin that we committed, we wouldn't be allowed to come into church on Sunday morning. And we put a check mark by it. Somebody said to me, well, Pastor, you know, I'm trying and I'm just human. I know you're human. But God said, that's why I gave you something. Because by yourself, you can't do it. By yourself, you're going to keep regular law. I had to give you something that would help you not to put a check mark every time they do wrong. And I had to give you a part of me. I gave you a part of the Trinity. Don't you know what I put in you? And when it hovered over darkness, when God gave the command, and God allowed the Spirit to bring forth light, well, that same power is on the inside of you. No, you can't do it by yourself. But if you allow the Holy Spirit to take control of your life, then you won't keep score. And then number three. When we stop honoring our neighbor above ourselves. Here's what Paul said in Romans 12:10. Be devoted to one another in brotherly, sisterly love. Honor one another above yourself. Watch this. Honor one another above yourself. To honor means to give them high value and respect. Watch this. To give them high value and respect. This involves agape love. We honor them because they were created in the image of God. That's why we honor them, because what? They were created in the image of God. We give them high value and respect. Don't you know that's what God does for us? that mean? I'm more concerned about you going to heaven than I am about getting back at you. And when I'm more concerned about you going to heaven than I am getting back at you, because I realize that God didn't get back at me. I messed up this morning. Amen. You know, sometimes we say, you know, the Bible says there are sins of omission and commission. Listen, what if God got me back? For everything I did from last Sunday to this Sunday. But don't you know what God does? God holds us in honor. But when you don't hold people in honor, your love will grow cold. Jesus did not let his love grow cold. Even though the Jews rejected him, he didn't let his love grow cold.
Yes.
Even though the preachers lined up against him and wanted to kill him, he didn't let his love grow cold. Even when Peter and the other disciples abandoned him, he didn't let his love grow cold. Even though Pilate crucified him, he didn't let his love grow cold. Even when they had him on the cross and the crowd mocked him, he didn't let his love grow cold. And because his love did not grow cold, Jesus, he stayed on the cross because he loved you and he loved me. He thought about you and he thought about me. He hung there with all of the sins of the world on his shoulder, and he did not let his love grow cold. And because he didn't let his love grow cold, he went down into hell
Aren't you glad? That his love doesn't grow cold.
Yes.
In other words, that his mercy endures. Forever. And ever. Doesn't know him in the free pardon of your sin.
Yes. Yes.
And so we offer Christ to you.
Yes.
Today is a day of salvation. Let not this day pass you by. Or maybe you that one whose love has turned cold toward your neighbor. Nothing to be ashamed of. Because his love doesn't grow cold. He says, come to me. All you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So come and allow the blood of Jesus to wash you, cleanse you, restore you. Oh, Jesus. Or maybe you just need prayer today. The ministers are in the aisle. They're willing to pray with you. Maybe so that that coldness can be removed from your heart. Invite you to come. There's room at the altar.